and welcome. St Paul's School for Girls, a public school in central London which is regarded as so worthwhile that parents will pay a lot of money to send their daughters there. My guest today has been High Mistress there for the past 10 years and she's only recently retired, Mrs Alison Munro. In fact, you went there as a child yourself, didn't you, to St Paul's?
Well, I was 16 when I went there. I was there for just over 2 years.
Did you enjoy the school and has it changed much now that you've become headmistress?
Well, of course it's changed. It would be very dead if it hadn't, but in lots of ways it hasn't changed. I think some of the good things have still remain.
What sort of things struck you right away, though, when you actually went to the school again?
Well, I came from a large high school, which nowadays would be called a comprehensive school, and the thing that struck me straight away was that people didn't seem to be playing the fool quite as much as they'd been, and people were rather serious-minded. Everybody had a sort of sense of purpose and was setting about their business, and this impressed me enormously.
As a child, did the school have lots of uniforms, lots of rules, and was it rather rigid?
Well, I was 16, so there wasn't a great enforcement of uniform, but there were very strict rules about talking in corridors. But that was all. It was a school that seemed remarkably free of regulation compared to the school I'd come from.
You've had a very successful and varied career. Have you deliberately plotted it?
Oh, no. No, no. So, I don't think anybody can plot their life. No, I think it's a chapter of accidents. I've changed course once or twice, which has made it interesting.
What sort of things made you change course, though?
Well, after my husband was killed when I was quite young and left me with a baby, so I went into the civil service and the war was on, so it wasn't too difficult to get in, and then I got one of the places that they offered at the end of the war in the civil service, and so I stayed there for over 20 years, bringing up my family.
Do you think the fact that you were a public school girl influenced your progress in your career?
I'm not so sure, because after all I'm only a bit of a public school girl. I was only there for the last 2 years. I certainly wasn't at a public school before that. No, I think the fact that I went to Oxford influenced my career, if I'm honest. I think that did give me an advantage in my generation.
Did you, being a woman and being successful in a career, did you ever feel that you were discriminated against in any way, or did you ever feel that perhaps you had to be better than all the men around you to succeed?
Well, the last bit, yes. I think you've got to try and be better. I don't think the civil service is very good like us. It's one of the better professions. I don't think I was discriminated against, except when I first came in. I mean, the first man who had to work under me turned his back on me and said he was nagged all night at home, so why should he be nagged all day by a woman? But that's the only thing I remember. No, in fact, I think it gave me certain advantages because I was conspicuous, whereas a man might not have been.
What do you say to the girls at St Paul's about careers? Do you encourage them to be very ambitious?
Well, no, I think ambition's a rather nasty word. I encourage them to have a full life. I say life is for living, and the more qualified they are, the better the life they'll have. But I also encourage them to get married and have children. I think they want to experience everything and have a rich life.
But do you think that marriage and a career are ever really compatible? I mean, let me put it this way. You see, I feel that your husband died and therefore you were, in a way, forced into another job as well as being a mother and a wife. Mm. But nowadays, if a woman who is married and has children also wants to have a job, she's often regarded as being selfish and it's a bit wrong. What are your views
about
it?
Well, I think this is changing. I agree it has been awfully difficult, and the woman who does a job, she has a sense of guilt. But now there's a most marvellous fact emerged. I mean, now we're advised by all the child psychologists that a child needs to be away from its mother when it's quite tiny for a little bit each day. And this does enable the woman who's intelligent and she's got young children to at least keep her hand in. If she's a doctor, she can keep up her expertise. If she's in the publishing world, and so on. It is possible to keep going during that period when the children are young. And now what is necessary is that, I'm sorry, you've got me on something I feel rather strongly, but industry and commerce have now, if they want to get the use of this woman's force, they've got to adjust to the woman's life cycle and make it possible for the woman to re-enter at 35 instead of expecting her to climb onto the man's career ladder at that age, which is almost impossible.
There are some laws being passed, aren't there, to sort of stop the discrimination against women. Do you think this ever really will make any difference at all?
I think it's attitudes. I mean, things got... what is going to change is the need for the women power. I mean, a good woman mathematician is needed, and employers will adjust their practices to get the use of a good woman. This has got to spread. People are beginning to realise an awful lot of wasted manpower tied up in the woman power as well.
So, in fact, what would you say to some parents who feel still that it's not really necessary to educate a girl at all, and that she's only there for marriage?
Criminal. Those parents are absolutely criminal, as they get married and live happily ever after. I mean, those parents are just producing a very boring wife. I mean, I think most parents that I meet recognise that if they want their daughter to have a full life, she's got to be educated, because if she's going to be married, and even if she stays at home, she's got to be an interesting person for her husband to come home to, and that requires education.
What do you feel about the men's attitude to women in work? Do you feel in any way that they feel threatened by women at all?
Well, there are pockets where one is aware of that, but on the whole, you know, if you work among men, they forget about it after a time. They accept you for what you are. I mean, you're not spending your whole time flirting with everyone. You see, or you might find one or two you might want to, but I think they accept you for what you are after a time.
Well, as I said, you've had a very successful career and very varied, and your last venture was to become the High Mistress of St. Paul's. Now, how did you get this job, and what made you take it on?
I can't really answer that question. I suppose I was coming up to the age of 50, which I think most people feel like changing their course then, and they were advertising the post, and at a dinner party one night, we got talking about this vacancy and various ideas, and I said flippantly, well, of course you want me there. And I'm afraid that did start a whole chain of things, which led to my going there. And I felt I was wanting a job where I'd pull out a few different stops than from the ones I'd been pulling out in the civil service. I loved the civil service. It's a marvellous career for a woman. But I didn't want to go on doing it forever.
In what way did you think that your job in the civil service helped you as High Mistress of St. Paul's, if it indeed did?
I wonder if it did at all. It helps you because it gives you a certain confidence. I mean, if you're in the administrative side of the civil service, they do instill in the idea that you can really tackle anything, because all problems can be broken down into smaller problems. They do instill this kind of confidence. But I have to admit, when I got into the school, where the whole world was a mass of detail and children and small affairs, it was quite a big change.
You're not, in fact, a trained teacher, are you?
No.
So
no.
This is...
I do teach, though. I have taught in my 10 years at St. Paul's, but I'm not a trained teacher.
Well, how did your... the teachers at St. Paul's then react to the appointment of, we could say, an administrator?
Well, I think they observed cautiously to begin with, but of course I went very slowly to start with because I had so much to learn. But I think, well, the head of my maths department summed it up, and she said, well, we made up our mind to accept you, and we have.
What sort of problems do you remember in those first years?
The detail, you see, because if you're in the administrative civil servant, you're taught not to deal with detail. You always delegate that down to somebody in a lower grade. I mean, it's beneath you. And suddenly my world was detail. I mean, Mary wanted to go to the dentist. Jane wanted to enter for Oxford and wouldn't, all this kind of thing. And this, for the first year, did rather baffle me. And then I realised, of course, what everybody does in a pastoral situation. You must get to know every single child. And then it becomes alive and interesting and fascinating. So I spent my first year concentrating on knowing every single child and about her. And then it took on a new dimension.
I'm interested to hear that you actually did teach. What did you teach?
Well, the things I knew about: government, social studies, politics, institutions, this kind of thing, after the senior girls. What they call the GOW, the Great Outside World, they used to call my lessons.
Oh, that sounds marvellous. Because that brings me again to this area of the administrator running, as it were, the school instead of a head teacher. Do you think that this is probably one of the answers to the problem of lack of staff in state schools, that we often promote our teachers to become head teachers and therefore lose them in the classroom? And would you like to see perhaps someone like yourself as a high teacher or head teacher in state schools?
No, I don't think I advocate the pattern. I think a lot of teachers do show administrative acumen and come to prefer it, and these are the people who make head teachers. On the whole, a headmistress, I think, does need a teaching background. I pull my governor's leg on this. I say you took an enormous risk appointing me without any background at all. And I'm not sure that I would advocate it, although I'm very keen that teachers should get out of school for a bit. I think it's terribly bad to take over a big school never having moved out of the school environment. I think that is necessary. But I don't think I would advocate as a general rule administrators coming in with no background.
Why do you think it's necessary to get out?
Well, I think the children require it now. The children will respect you more if they think you have some knowledge. I mean, they're interested in what they call relevance. They're interested in the world they're going to live in. And if they feel they're being taught by somebody who has a knowledge of that world, even if it's a limited knowledge, I think they are more effective.
Well, let's look at the dangers of being an administrator in a school world. Isn't there a danger that you don't really understand what the problems are facing teachers and facing the children?
Well, then you're a bad administrator, if that is so. I mean, I think one must try very hard, because the problems are enormous, as you know, in the present teaching situation, and I think this is your job to put yourself in there and to find out.
Of the careers that you've had so far, Mrs. Munro, which do you think you've enjoyed most of all?
Well, I've enjoyed them all, and I hope I'm going to enjoy my new one.
Yeah. Over the 10 years, what do you think that you've added to in St. Paul's?
Well, the compliment which I relish, and I hope it's founded, is that I've got the school completely tuned in to a young, modern society, and yet I've maintained its standards. This is what I like to think.
Well, I think that's a nice time, in fact, to take a break, because we'll be able to talk in the second half of the programme about what you actually did with St. Paul's. So don't go away just now. We're going to take a short break, but we'll be with you again and hear about the School for Girls, St. Paul's.